Time and time again, a hot topic that has been continually asked for has been what were the ranks and command structure within samurai armies. And this is somewhat of a topic that I have decided to steer clear of, largely because the answer is not simple. Not only do samurai armies not link up well with Western military examples, but also the composition of samurai armies vary wildly. Not only across the many periods of Japanese history, but even more so down to each specific lord or family. And although we can see similarities across the board, overall, every leader had their own unique way of organizing their military. Samurai armies were like snowflakes, each one unique from the last. If you wanted to ask, hey, how did samurai distinguish their unit captains? I would first have to ask which daimyo or clan were you thinking about, because each lord pretty much did things differently from one another, which means it is really impossible to say this is how things were, this is what it looked like for all samurai and samurai armies, when in reality we can only paint a broad generalization if we are not looking particularly at one specific clan. So then, what can we say about this topic? What can be pointed out and learned in a broad sense to give you a better understanding of basically the inner workings of samurai armies? Well, what I personally feel might be the best course of action is to go through some common samurai military terms and ranks, and then examine not only a hypothetical command structure, but also the army composition of several significant daimyo during the later years of the Sengoku Jidai, the real peak of samurai warfare. And this will be done largely using examples from Osprey Publications, which provide very nice detailed diagrams of the command structure behind these armies. This video is hopefully going to give you a better understanding of samurai military chain of command, as well as some unique terminology and overall classifications. We are going to get very technical here, and I will try my best not to get too confusing with a lot of these concepts being covered, but with any luck, we can come out of this with a better understanding of samurai armies. So, with that said, let's dive in. Now, the first thing I feel we should logically cover before getting in too deep is in fact some of the ranks and terminology. Understanding these first will help us later when we begin talking about overall command structures within armies. To start with, let's get the obvious out of the way. Daimyo, vassals, and retainers. Daimyo were the feudal lords of the Sengoku period, ambitious warlords who led mighty samurai clans. Militarily, they can be called sotaisho, which roughly translates to mean the main commander-in-chiefs of their armed forces. Under them, we see their vassals, known as kashin, lords of prominent but lesser families who had sworn allegiance to a daimyo. And although certain vassals were very loyal to specific regional powers, others were a bit more opportunistic and were more inclined to simply place their support behind whichever daimyo seemed strongest, even if it meant betraying one they had served for many years. The structure of vassals can be broken down in many ways with a wide variety of terms. But to keep it simple, the three I think you should know above all else were Ichimon, who were the actual relatives to the daimyo, Fudai, who were considered inner lords, those who had been loyal for many years and were very trusted, and lastly, Tozama, who were considered somewhat outsiders. Vassals get sort of lumped together with the concept of retainers, also known as kinju, vassals who could be relied upon and called up for service by the daimyo, basically retained for use, thus giving them the name retainers. Retainers were subordinate higher-up figures who were trusted and given plenty of direct influence. They were consultants, strategists, and taskmasters. They were essentially the highest echelon of personal service to their lord. Both vassals and retainers make up what is known as a daimyo's kashindan, or retainer band. Having a mighty kashindan both in strength and structure was integral to military success. And it is right here that we need to take a quick second to discuss leadership by merit. Although heads of families were guaranteed important leadership positions, that same level was not always guaranteed to other family members. Samurai armies placed high emphasis on status by merit. If you were in a high-up leading position, commanding troops, you should have earned that position, either through seniority or experience. Prominent leadership positions were not always handed out to sons, brothers, nephews, and so on, just because they were in the family, as the most forward-thinking daimyo fully understood that they needed figures of quality and talent to lead their troops. And if their own family was not up to par, they may be given lesser leadership positions within the army, while those more deserving were given high command. But getting back into it, many of these leading figures who were promoted to a position like general were known as taisho, and they can be further broken down into samurai taisho and ashigaru taisho, obviously depending on what they were in command of. And it is important to recognize the significance of the ashigaru taisho, perhaps a bit more than the samurai taisho. This is not only because the ashigaru taisho had a bit more troops they were responsible for, but also that they had the task of ensuring that common peasant foot soldiers performed exceptionally well, even when compared to their more highly trained and disciplined samurai counterparts. Now, below the daimyo and his high command were the many different types of bugyo. The word bugyo itself is one that roughly translates to sort of mean commissioner or military administrator. The bugyo were not always in charge of field command, but rather were figures who carried out various services to ensure that all parts of the army were working together like a well-oiled machine. They were essentially figures who oversaw the many different subdivisions of samurai armies. The important bugyo to know were the ikusa bugyo, the main army commissioner, the yori bugyo, yumi bugyo, and tippo bugyo, the mako bugyo, who was in charge of setting up the field headquarters, the hata bugyo, who was in charge of the organization of a wide variety of unique specific flags and banners used throughout the army, the yoroi bugyo, the shodogu bugyo, the hyoro bugyo, the konida bugyo, the daidokuro bugyo, who was in charge of meals for the army, and even the fune bugyo, for when armies needed transport across water. But there were also two other roles that were held as sort of equal to that of the bugyo. These were that of the metsuke and yokome, with metsuke being sort of considered as army superintendents and yokome being inspectors. Off the campaign and during peacetime, figures with these unique titles acted in a disciplinary fashion. Yet, when attached to an army, their role slightly changed as they oversaw the army as a whole, examining individual samurai and ashigaru performance and identifying examples of bravery and heroics, as well as cowardice. They also played a role in settling inner debates, as well as keeping track of heads taken during battle, ensuring the validity of the taken head and linking it to the supposed person who took it, making sure that no foul play was at hand. From the taisho to the bugyo, along with the metsuke and yokome, these ranks all fell within the all-encompassing term hatamoto, those that stand beneath the banner, figures under the direct command of the daimyo. But this is surprisingly a very broad term, but one that usually just represents the elite guard of the daimyo, which not only protected him but also carried out his most important tasks. In fact, the elite guard of the Hatamoto, in the case of the Oda and Toyotomi, iconically get labeled as horoshu, due to the massive horos they distinctively wore on their backs. But as we've seen, the Hatamoto were more than just guards, and can be further broken down into subunits known as ban. These included mounted units, foot units, and even highly mobile messengers, who wore a unique horo or sashimono to distinguish themselves. For example, messengers of the Takeda clan wore a sashimono with the symbol of a centipede, and by those of the Tokugawa, wore one with the kanji symbol for the number 5. There were also figures known as sandal bearers in this group who looked after the equipment of significant higher-ranking samurai, ensuring their armor was well-maintained, weapons sharpened and polished, and horses groomed. They would also carry a significant samurai's helmet during marches. Within the Hatamoto, we also see the color guard, carriers of massive banners or three-dimensional ornate army insignias. Other than that, the ranks of the Hatamoto also extend into a number of other unique figures that would accompany a daimyo on campaign, from doctors to Buddhist priests to entertainers and hunters and even shinobi agents. We can truly see that the Hatamoto title extended far beyond the typical role of guard it is often associated with. Below the Hatamoto, we start to get into the individual units of soldiers called kumi. Within each unit, there was usually one samurai captain known as a kashira, and several samurai lieutenants known as kumigashira. It was these captains and lieutenants who really led the bulk of the ashigaru foot soldiers on the battlefield. And it is important to remember that the real backbone of samurai armies in the Sengoku Jidai had become the ashigaru foot soldier, and not the samurai warriors who led them. Ashigaru had become the main component to samurai armies as foot soldier tactics had become more and more relevant ever since the end of the Mongol invasions in the 1200s. The ratio of samurai to ashigaru, on average, now was around 4 samurai to every 12 ashigaru, or to put it more simply, 1 to 3. Samurai still played a large role, obviously, when it came to heavy cavalry and infantry units, as well as unit commanders on the battlefield. But the main battle line troops were not samurai, but rather conscripted foot soldiers armed with a spear, bow, or matchlock firearm. And it is here, now that we have outlined many of the ranks, roles, and terms, that I want to now go and show some of the command structures you would often find in late period Sengoku armies. Now, before we get into specific figures, I quickly want to show off a display of a typical late-period Sengoku army, as found in Osprey's Samurai Army book. As the title says, this is a hypothetical command structure of a samurai army around the year 1590, before the Imjin War and before the Battle of Sekigahara. At the center of the army is obviously the daimyo, where everyone from that point branches off. Directly within the hatamoto of the daimyo are his officials, guards, and personal attendants. We see the main army commissioner, the Ikusa Bugyo, and although the daimyo was usually the commander-in-chief, this commissioner might also be given that role. I would imagine a less militarily skilled daimyo, such as Imagawa Yoshimoto, would have entrusted someone like Seisai Taigen to be his sōtaisho. Branching off from the Ikusa Bugyo were the rest of the Bugyo, who all have their significant and unique role within the army. But also, below him is where we see the rest of the Taisho generals. In this hypothetical setup, we have 3 samurai Taisho and 3 Ashigaru Taisho. And below them are the many different kumi or subunits of soldiers, both samurai and Ashigaru respectively. Now, this layout gives us a fantastic depiction of a late Sengoku period command structure at the real apex of samurai warfare. And if we wanted to, we could just stop right here. But I think it is important to now throw out a few examples of different samurai armies so that we can see what particular daimyo did differently from each other, and how armies sort of evolved over time. The first example I want to share is one much earlier. This is that of Uesugi Kenshin's army around the year 1559. By this point in time, the great clans across Japan were still relatively small compared to what a lot of them would later grow into. Thus, the size and sophistication of many armies was much smaller and less complex. This example shows Kenshin's army right in the midst of his many clashes with Takeda Shingen over the Kawanakajima Plain. Right away, you can see how less detailed his command structure was. As we see, Kenshin was at the top. But under him, starting from the left, we have his blood relatives, the Ichimon, who under them command what looks to be the smallest portion of the army. Next over, we have the Fudai, his trusted inner lords, who command what looks to be the largest portion of the army outside of the Kunishu. This would be made up of soldiers from each lord's own domain. But lastly, we have 2 divisions of provincial troops, which make up really the main body of Kenshin's army. The Uesugi army in 1559 is a fine example of the simple warband of earlier Sengoku armies. If we fast forward roughly a decade, we can immediately start to see a much more complex system laid out. A primary example is that of Oda Nobunaga in 1570. By this point, Nobunaga had seized the capital and was on his rise to power, contending with enemies on all sides of him. In this display, we see an updated and much more complex command structure than what was just shown before. However, I do need to point out that this is not a diagram of the General Oda army, but rather the Kashindan or retainer band under Nobunaga. Nevertheless, it still showcases a far more detailed chain of command. At the top, we have the daimyo, Oda Nobunaga himself. But below him, we go in 2 different interesting directions. The Ichizoku, which is another way to say his blood relatives, but also the Shukuro, a senior vassal, in this case Shibata Katsuie, who leads the rest of his commanders. Under Katsuie, we see the other senior retainers, and it is not until under them that we finally get to the Bugyo commissioners for the army. You also have the Fudai inner lords, but we also see Tozama outsider lords listed within the army as well. And although this depiction is not nearly as detailed as the hypothetical example from 1590, I want to go just one step further and show you how this diagram branches out under a specific general to become a much more complex system. Let us look at Hideyoshi. A diagram set 3 years later shows a relatively simple system, branching off to only three separate command groups: his relatives, inner lords, and newcomers. Now, compare that to his Kashindan by the year 1581. Granted, Hideyoshi had been continually promoted over the past decade and was considered one of the most prominent figures in the Oda clan. Still, the level of sophistication just in his own retainer band is much more detailed, especially given the fact that this was still while he served under Oda Nobunaga. His command structure now branches off to incorporate his horse guard, which all have their own subdivisions, his subordinate generals, who then branch off to command troops pulled from a variety of provinces, and he is even shown to have a division dedicated to the Kosho, samurai pages or squires. Pulling this back to the hypothetical example from 1590, we can really start to see how the complexity of samurai military command structure evolved over time to really incorporate so many layers. It shows that as major clans grew more and more powerful, so too did the level of intricacy in their armies, as more detail needed to be accounted for. But as I mentioned at the start, no two samurai armies were the same, as each daimyo and clan really had their own way of doing things. So like I said, a lot of the information presented here, besides the Uesugi and Oda examples, are really just broad generalizations. If you want to learn more about specific armies for specific lords or clans, that is something you are going to have to try to find info for and dive into separately from other info provided about other samurai armies. I know this is a very confusing topic, and it was hard enough for me to try and sift through it and present it to you in a reasonable fashion, but if I did get anything wrong that you may have noticed, please correct me in the comments below. Obviously, I was not trying to make an hour-long in-depth documentary going into this subject. Rather, I want to give you names and pictures of what Sengoku army command structures might look like, which is what I hope I was able to help do for you. So with that said, thank you for watching, and don't forget to like, subscribe, and ring the notification bell if you enjoyed this video and found it to be most informative.